perfectly all right. We're gonna adjust just a bit. Y'all, come on, Jesse. You come here, son. We gotta flip a little bit. We had just a 1 ounce of twist. Put it in right front. Thank y'all good. I don't know about you, but I love Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
You gonna get you ready?
I'm ready.
You always ready. Listen, Molly, son.
Dreamed I went to heaven, you were there with me.
Oh, yeah.
We walked upon the streets of gold, beside the crystal sea.
Oh, yeah.
I heard the angels singing, as someone called your name.
Oh, yes.
You turned and saw this young man,
yes.
And he was smiling as he came. And he said, friend, you may not know me now. Then he said, but wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. Every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. One day, when you said that prayer, I asked you, in my heart.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you for giving to the Lord.
Oh, yes.
Because I have a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
I am so glad you gave. And then another man stood before you. He said, remember the time a missionary came to your church and his pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Gift you gave,
yes.
That's why I'm in heaven today. He said, thank you for giving to the Lord. 'Cause I have a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you came.
Amen.
One by one they came, as far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by his generosity. The little things that you had done, all the sacrifices made, noticed on the earth, but in heaven now proclaimed. And I know up in heaven, we're not supposed to cry, but I'm almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand. You stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord.
Uncle Howard,
I am alive. That was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. so glad you came. Y'all know it, sing it with me. Thank you for giving to the Lord. 'Cause I am a life that's been changed. John 14, he said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I told you so. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go to prepare a place for you, I come again receiving to myself that where I am, there you may be also. Now, you got to realize, Jesus was headed to Calvary. He was headed to the Garden of Gethsemane when this took place. You need to realize, hey, he knows what's going to transpire. The best is yet to come. I won't preach on by the help of the Lord. God gave me this. Look what I traded for a mansion.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. I think about Alvin. Boy, what a true friend he was to this preacher. I love your preacher to death. Me and him were best. But matter of fact, I was with him the 4th of July weekend. We went out and eat lunch together, supper together. We was in a motel room together, camping together. I love Brother Alvin. Boy, he was a precious dear brother to me, and I thank God for the opportunity to stand here today and be able to have a part in his funeral. But I thought about what this says here today. I thought about that he traded sin for salvation. Amen. I'm telling something, my friend. I'm glad to know that Brother Alvin was saved. Amen. One of the greatest things you can have in your life is being born again by the Spirit of God. I'm glad there's a day that the Holy Ghost came down where he was. I'm glad there's a day the Spirit of God came where he was and showed him he's lost. Amen. I'm glad he got saved. I'm glad there's a God that can change minds and change hearts when nobody else can. You need to realize, my friend, the Bible said in Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 13, 14, he said, whomever you trusted, you heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, and whomever you believed, you were sealed the Holy Spirit of promise. And now think about this, for it's your earnest inheritance unto the redemption, purchase, and possession, and to the praise of God. I'm glad there's a day that the hour got sealed with the precious Spirit of God. Amen. You ever been around Albert Bone? He'll tell you about Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen, preacher. You couldn't get around Brother Albert Bone. He wasn't going to tell you about the Lord. Amen. He'll leave a track there and see something there. He'll tell you about the Lord. Amen. I think about he traded sin for salvation. I think about this. He traded, think about this, suffering for shouting.
Yes.
Amen, preacher.
Yep.
Hey, he's been through some rough roads. I'm going to tell you something, my friend. If you ever pastor a church, you don't know what rough roads are to you pastor a church. Say amen, preacher. I've been a pastor for 30 years. I know what it's about. Amen. I tell you, my friend, the hardships, the problems, the difficult times, the things you got to go through in life, the problems you got to deal with in life, oh, they're all over. They're all over. I can see Brother Alvin now just to say, just God to say, it's like he said, hey, preacher, it's good. It's good. I think about, hey, when he opened his eyes in the hospital room, Brother Doug, amen, sister, friends, he opened his eyes in the hospital room. He saw something we couldn't see. He saw something we couldn't get hold of. Hey, he saw the blessed Savior happen. Lord God, hey, I'm glad, praise God. Hey, he's having a time, and he traded suffering for shouting. He's shouting over there. Hey, I'll tell you something. He'll say, don't weep over me. He said, don't weep over me. I'm having myself. He said, I'm shouting it out. Amen. Yeah. Praise God. Now listen. I've been around that long enough.
I never know Albert to get up and run through a church and chat. Am I right? Am I telling the truth? Have you ever remember that? You remember him running through a church chat? By me right now, he's running through heaven, chat. Nobody made me believe on earth, he's running through heaven, chat. He's running all over the place, having himself a time, amen. Hey, you got to realize, he's not worried about nothing. It's all over, life's over. The burden, the hardship of life is behind.
Yes.
He's having himself a time, rejoicing in the goodness of God. Amen, praise God. Amen. And hold on your seat, we're going to get even better, amen. Right. I think about the Bible said in 1 Peter 4:12-13, beloved, now, think not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is the trying that some things happen in you, but rejoice. It's much that you are partakers of Christ's service, that when his glory shall be revealed, you shall be, he knows that you may be glad with exceeding joy. When his glory shall be revealed, one day, hey, I will see it. Make me want to run. Albert, sing that glory over on the other side. He sings something on the other side that we ain't seen yet. We ain't seen it yet. You know why? Because one day it ain't over. But one day it is going to be for us. We need to realize. No, he traded. Sin for salvation, suffering, shouting. I think about it, traded searching for sin. He's always preached about it. He's always talked about Jesus. He's always talked about heaven. He's preached about heaven, what heaven's about, what heaven's going to be like. He's preached about it many years. This dear man of God's preached about heaven for many years. Now, he's seeing. He's seeing what it's about. Oh, you need to realize the Bible said in 2 Corinthians 5:8, he said, we're confident, we'll rather say, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. He's present with Jesus. Oh, he's rejoicing, having several times. I think about this afternoon. That was just my introduction. Amen. I think about this afternoon. I think about, number one, I want to preach on three things. And I'm done. Amen. I'm not a long-winded preacher. I'm normally a 45-minute preacher. And it could be here an hour. Amen. But I don't think the Lord be in that. Amen. He didn't want to let me do that. I hope I was ready for it. I had one ready. Amen. He wouldn't let me do it. Big and high. But I think about, hey, I'm going to talk about number one, Albert's love. Albert had love like nobody else had.
Right.
You said, what do you mean, preacher? He loved his companion.
Yes.
You know, he told me this past 4th of July, sister. He said, I got friends to spoil. He told me that 4th. I mean, we've got to meet. He said, he called up on the phone. He's talking to her. A little while, he got a phone. He said, I got her spoiled. I said, what do you mean, brother? Right, what do you mean, God's for? He said, Lord, preacher. He said, I got to go fill the tank and carb with gas. He said, I keep everything right. He said, then I said, well, you like me. I wash dishes. I run my house. Run the vacuum cleaner, run the dishwasher, run the wash tank. Amen. He said, amen, preacher. I do the same thing. Amen. But I'm telling you, my friend, thank God for a precious wife, companion.
Amen.
Lord, he loved Francis. You will be around Albert long, he'll talk about Francis.
Yeah. Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
You'll be around long, he'll say, I say, how's everything home? He said, oh, everybody's doing good. Francis doing well. I said, let me ask you a question. Is she taking care? He said, Lord, yeah, he keeps everything. Listen, church. I was in a motel with him. He had everything folded up. Am I telling this right, sister? And folded up. It was neat. Everything was neat. Sucked, took away. And he done something that's unusual, and I couldn't figure this out. And it blew my mind. And every time we met, we was a camp meeting for years. And we went to a motel. We stayed at motel. Me and him stayed at motel for years. He did something just knocked me out of my seat in that motel. He did every time we come together camp meeting. He put air freshener in the bathroom. Every time he come out, he put air freshener in the bathroom. I said, preacher, what you got? He said, oh, preacher, you got to have things right. Amen. Got to have things right. Amen. We carried on. We had time. Me and him had more fun than you shake a stick at.
Yeah.
But you got to realize the love he had for his companion. I think about he loved Sister Francis. He loved her so much. The Bible says something about that. Proverbs 18:22 said, who findeth the wife findeth the good thing.
Oh, yeah.
And obtain favor of the Lord. He found a good thing when he got hold of Francis. He ain't never let him go. Till now. Amen!
Yep.
A good thing. Some of you guys need to learn this.
Yeah.
You're preacher, amen. Hallelujah. Now think about it. Not Albert's love for his companion, Albert's love for his children. He loved his kids. He bragged on his kids. I asked him how many grandbabies. He told me how many grandbabies he had. He told me how his children do, as we talked about all that. I'm telling you, Albert loved his children. You had a daddy that loved you. He loved you.
Oh, yeah.
Prayed for you. Called your name out to God. He loved you. Amen. The Bible says in Proverbs 22:6, train up a child away it should go. When it gets old, it should not depart from it. He taught your children, taught those kids the right way. Amen. Thank God. Old-fashioned teaching. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Old-fashioned teaching the right way. Amen. Thank God for that. Amen. Oh, but now think about it. No, Abba's love for his companion, Abba's love for his children, Abba's love for his church. He loved this church.
Amen.
He loved this church. He loved Liberty Baptist Church. Liberty was a special place for him. Now, he told me something, and I thought, Albert, you ain't got no sense. He said he got in that steeple when they put that steeple on the roof of this church. Some of you been here long enough know what I'm talking about. Hey, got in that. I said, you mean you tell me you caught him in that? He said, I sure did. I caught him in that steeple. He said, I got up in the attic. I went to places they couldn't get into the attic. I said, yeah, I believe that. Amen. I said, I definitely couldn't get in there. Amen. But it happened. I thank God what he meant to. He loved the church. I'm telling my friend. Oh, what we live in days where people fall in love with the church. The church is one of the greatest places you could ever be at. It's being the house of God. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Good to see Landon Cobb here. Landon, you know what I'm talking about. Boy, he loved Monta Vista. Amen. He loved that place. That's where I ran into Albert. See how we ran into Albert in the Monta Vista Academy. Up in Asheville, North Carolina. That's where we ran into one another. That's how we got acquainted with one another. That's how we got hooked up with one another. Amen. And we always been going to camp meeting for every year. But I think about my friend. Number see Albert's love. I think about number two today. We were quickly. We see Albert's labor.
Yeah. Yeah.
Boy, Albert was a very smart man.
Amen.
He told me, and I don't know. He told me this when he left camp. I don't know if it, he said, preacher, I got a book that's supposed to come out from the press any day. And he says, I want you to have a copy of that. He said, I'll mail you a copy when I get one. I said, he told me that when he left camp meeting up there. I said, really? He said, I've written not many books. But you know what? Albert was a great witness. He witnessed to people. I'll tell you something. The slogan in this cast is so true. He lived what he preached.
Amen.
Now you're talking about a real preacher.
Yep.
There's things.
Amen.
There's things in my life, and there's things no doubt in this preacher right here's life, because they like, hey, we ain't pleased with it. But this man right here walked with God. Yep. This man right here served God. This man right here lived for God. He was real. He was a witness. The Bible said, and think about this. He said in Luke 14:23, and he said, going how he's hedged, compelled to come that my house may be filled. He went and knocked on doors, went and spread the gospel. He wasn't a witness for Jesus. He wasn't ashamed of the Lord. Amen. He was a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. No, he was a witness, but he was a watching. He watched after church members. I'm going to tell you something.
Yeah.
You lost a preacher. Now, I love you. Like what I'm going to say. You lost a preacher that prayed for you.
Amen.
I'm telling the truth. Am I right, sister? He prayed for this church. He prayed for these members. I'll tell you something. Money can't buy prayers.
Amen.
Money can't buy a prayer warrior. He was a true prayer warrior. My friend, he was a witness. He witnessed for God. He served God. He walked with God. He did what he could for the glory of God. But yet, he was watching after people's lives. He was worried more about you than he was himself.
Amen.
So I'll tell you something. That's what God wants us to be, a good witness for him. A good watch. They might obey them to have the rule over you. As Mitchell says, they may watch for your souls. They may give an account. They may do it with joy, not with grief. That's unprofitable to you. No, we see he was a witness. He was watching. Number three, he was worshiping. Brother Albert learned how to worship. Amen. Now let me tell you something. If a preacher wasn't preaching something right, he'd he can tell you right in a minute. He can tell you, say, that ain't right, man, ain't right. No, it's not right. That ain't right. He'll tell you. Amen.
Amen.
I'm telling you something about he knows how to worship. He'd get a hold of me, he said, we'd laugh and carry on, hug one another, cry, weep, shout. I'm telling you, my friend, what's happened to old time worship where people just let go and have themselves a time? Amen. I'm telling you, my friend, God wants us to worship him in spirit and in truth. The Bible said they that worship us worship him in spirit and in truth. Hey, what's happened to true worship? We wish worship God. I'm telling you something. Much I love Brother Albert. Albert loved Jesus. Amen.
Yeah.
Right there it is. That's the key to it all is Jesus.
Yeah.
It ain't me. It ain't you. It's nobody around us. It's all about Jesus.
Amen.
It's all about magnifying the Lord. It's all about magnifying him. Worship the Lord. Glorifying him. I think about it. Nobody say Albert's love. Albert's labor. I want to close this. Albert's alone. You say, crazy preacher, leave me alone. I'm a nut screwing right though. He waving that flag. He want to go home. He want to go be Jesus. I'm going to tell you something, my friend. Albert long for glory. You see, when me preacher, see the Savior. Every preacher's got a longing one day to go home. A longing one day to go home. You know why? Because Jesus died on that cross and shed his precious blood for you and me, reaching the gospel of one half down to the prayer of the man in the other half and bring us together. He's our mediator between us and God. Amen. To save our souls and change, and rose again the third day to give us the victory over life. I thank God, my friend. We get to heaven, it's going to be. I'm going to find this person, I'm going to find that person. Nah, I'm going to see Jesus. I just want to see Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen. The Bible said in 1 John 3:2, beloved, now we're the sons of God, and up here what we should be. But yet when we know when he shall appear, we shall see him like he is. We're going to see him one day. We're going to see him as he is. Thank God there's a better day coming.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Then I think about, no, he wants to see Jacob. He's going to see the saints. He got some loved ones over there. Preacher friend.
Oh, yeah.
Doug, your daddy.
Yeah.
Huh? Just rejoicing.
Yeah.
Just shouting.
Yeah.
Woo! Amen!
Hey.
Have the time in glory. A.C. Carpenter. Yeah. I heard A.C. Carpenter led in Christ. Wow. What a war. I'm telling you, my friend, they're having a time over. They're rejoicing with the saints. The Bible said, Hebrews 12:1, wherefore, see what compass about with so great a kind of wit, let's lay aside every weight and sin which indeed spend us, and let's run the race with patience. I said, well, I'm telling you something, my friend. He's in that cloud of witnesses, rejoicing of what God's done. But I'm going to close this, and I'm done. He's one of me, preacher. I want to tell you something, church. I've preached about heaven. I've talked about it. I visioned my mind what it's going to be like. Every preacher has. Now he sees it. He sees it. Hallelujah. He sees it.
Yeah.
But you know what? I'm getting ready to see it. Bible said, for the Lord himself, he's not asking nobody up.
Right.
For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, voice of archangel, trump of God, and the dead in Christ arise first.
Amen.
I won't be in the graveyard when he comes. See them caskets open up, see Jesus take on to glory.
Yes.
And then we which are alive remain be called up there, meet the Lord in the clouds, so shall we ever be with the Lord. But church, let me tell you something. In order you get there, you've got to be born again.
Right.
You ain't going to get there by Brother Allen.
Nope.
You can't possibly. I'm going to follow this preacher to glory. It ain't going to happen. It won't work. You've got to be born again.
Yeah.
You've got to be washed in the blood. Your name's got to be written out. I'll say rejoice not because spiritual, but rejoice because your name is written in heaven.
Oh, yeah.
I'm telling you something, church. The best is yet to come. You know, in a few minutes, we're going to go to the graveside and say goodbye to a dear friend. But it may not be a little long. We may say hello on the other side.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The best is yet to come. Don't weep. Don't cry. Just shout it out. You say, why? He's right where God wants him to be. With Jesus. I told Donna, I said, when my mom and daddy died, that's what gave me so much great comfort was. The Lord hit me and said, I needed them more than you needed them. So I took them to the door with me, so I've got them on the other side helping me do what I need to do. Albert's helping the Lord. He's how you get that. You're with Jesus. I'll ask you something today. Are you born again? You know you're born again, you know you're saved. There's people got, they got religion. I ain't got religion. I got something kind of heaven said, the Holy Ghost salvation that changes you. Makes a difference in your life. I want you as a family. I love you. Thank you for letting me drive from King, North Carolina. You said, where's that at? In the country. We say to you and us and we, so that's what we say around our place. King, North Carolina. Now here, be a part of this funeral. I'm telling you, I love Brother Allen. I love this church. I love this family. Shall we pray? Father, come for you in Jesus' name. I pray for this family. I pray for Francis. God knows it's not easy. Not easy to sit there saying goodbye to her companion all these many years. They've been together. Lord, I thank you for what you've done in her life and her heart. I pray for Francis today. I pray you help her today, what she's going through. I pray for her daughter, Shirley, his daughter, Cheryl, and Alan. I pray God, Richardson. I pray God, you touch his family and help what they're going through. I pray you touch Cheryl today, touch Alan today, touch his family, help what they're going through, touch his daughter today, touch her grace and mercy. I pray for Doug, and I pray for Donna, help him what they're going through, touch Donna today, and help her what she's facing. And with her dad, pastor her dad, I pray for touch Donna today, bless her today. I pray for his son, I pray for Daniel. I pray, God, you touch Kimberly. God, you bless him today in heaven, what they're going through. And I pray for the 8 grandchildren, the 2 great-grandchildren. Lord, thank you, Lord, for the memories of Albert Hudson. I'm glad to know your soldier. Go home, my dear friend. I love you. You know I did. It's on the other side. I thank you what it meant to me. What it meant to my heart and life. I pray for us as church. Touch hearts, touch lives, touch your dear pastor. Fill the Holy Ghost power. Use you just a blessed Savior. Touch everything said that we done magnify your name in Jesus. Precious name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
such a privilege for those of us that are part of Liberty Baptist Church. It's a privilege to be at home. This is home to us. But it is such a privilege to be at home, to celebrate the homegoing of the man God used to make all this possible.
Amen.
My family got the honor of singing his favorite song. Brother Albert was going through a very difficult time. Precious little, him and his wife, precious little baby, Cheryl was a little bitty baby. He's in Bible college, trying to help a little church up the road. Struggling through a lot of things, and he had preached Jesus. He always did. Get back in the car, struggling through these things, and this song would come on. He had just listened, weep and cry, knowing God's got this thing. Would you listen while he sang? Determined in his heart to follow God, this place wouldn't be here.
Right.
Every one of us are affected by him. I think so much about the memories. I remember the first Wednesday night I came to this place 10 years ago, headed toward 11. I remember that first Wednesday night. I remember what God done in my heart before I ever came here. But I remember the memories of Brother Albert. I remember the life of him crying. While they were playing that song, if he was in his place, where he always said, him and Miss Francis, he was sitting there crying over those veils. But there were times, every Lord's Supper we had, that song was played. And every Lord's Supper for the last 10 years, I would stand behind that communion table and serve the deacons. And then he'd turn around and serve. Brother Albert would come. Serve me. I think about the time we worshiped together. As Brother Thomas done said, he wasn't a run the aisle shouter. He was far greater than that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You give me the choice of watching a man run the aisle shouting and watching a man worship like Albert Hudson, yes, Brother Albert did, I'll take Preacher Albert any day. Because I'm telling you, that's real. While that running around mess sometimes can get out of hand. Well, that's a little worked up stuff.
Yeah.
Amen. I remember the visits we had together. I remember when we first came, Brother Albert took me to see every member of this church that was not physically able to be here. I remember going to each one of them's house, and he introduced me to them. I remember one evening, we'd been out about visiting, and there was a particular young family that had a bunch of young kids that he wouldn't stop and see. We was in that big white Lincoln that he had, that last big car he had. He pulled that car down in there, in the gravel driveway. We went and knocked on the door. He talked to them about the Lord and tried to get them kids to come to church and wanted them to come to church. And he got that old Lincoln and put that thing in reverse, and God is my witness, he sandwiched underneath that car we talked that big. Ain't never let off the gas and ain't never looked back. I'm sitting there like, God, brother, he let up. First time I rode with Tanya said, "Well, how does he drive?" I said, "Just like a preacher." Wow, that's good. He took me off Black Mountain. I ain't been off Black Mountain much. We just moved up here. He took me off Black Mountain like I ain't ever been off Black Mountain in a while. I didn't expect that. I remember the times we sat down and discussed. And to have him, I remember when God put it on my heart. I knew that the first time I walked in here, I'd been pastor of this place. I knew it in my heart. I said it. I knew it was like that. But the condition was when I took the church, one condition that I put, then I didn't do the money, then I didn't do nothing, but that Brother Albert would be my associate on the way I take it. Because I knew there'd be years of gleaning stuff. I remember every single time we would have our time together and talk. I'd tell him and we'd talk and I'd ask advice. And this is what he'd always say. Now, preacher, you know you're the pastor, not me. But God's going to take care of it.
Amen.
Some of our church that's all they've ever known is Brother Albert. And they'd stand and they'd testify and they'd thank God for their pastors. And here he'd come. They wouldn't be able to get sat down. He'd stand up right back down back up yonder and he'd say, "Church, we ain't got but one pastor," and he's right up there, not me. That's what he'd say. He wanted them to know that he had been, wasn't. The last word we as a church heard from Brother Albert was standing in his spot right over there. He said, "I've been young, now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken." He stood right over here in the midst of all that with a gaze. He looked on his life in a little bit of a grin and a little bit of a pout and a little bit of a chuckle. And he said, "You know what? God ain't never let me down." Brother Keith Caleb brought it to my attention. I had never, in 10 years of pastoring, have never had a summer revival until this year. God put it on my heart. In July, we had a meeting. God knew Brother Albert loved revival.
Mm-hmm.
And God let him be enough for one last time.
Yes, sir.
Well, honestly, probably the best meeting it's ever been here since I've been the pastor. And God let Brother Albert enjoy it. Thanks, Caleb, for bringing it to my mind. Last words that I spoke to him, I spoke on the phone. I called him, and the first thing he was worried about was this. He wanted to know, was all those kids going over there, those trainees going over to Hills Crossing to get trained in the Good News Club? He wanted to know, because before he went in that hospital, he knew training day was coming, and he wanted to make sure that every one of those that were going was going to get trained. And then the last thing I heard him say, what did we talk about? He said, can I tell you a funny one, preacher? He said, God's got such a huge sense of humor. I said, what is it, Brother Albert? He said, there's a wall over here that's got a sign on it. And he said, on that sign it says, next to come, rapture. His, what I find so amazing about God, his, what is that, respiratory therapist's name was Rapture. Now, who in the name of God names their young and rapture? I thought it was weird that I got named Stacy as being a boy. But who named their young and Rapture? I ain't got no idea. But if they done it for one reason, they done it for Albert Hudson. And Albert Hudson said, you know what, preacher? As he laughed and enjoyed and he chuckled in himself, he said, guess what's next? The Rapture.
Amen.
Amen.
We get to enjoy all this for the very reason because Brother Albert answered a lot of calls.
Yes, sir.
Many, many, many years ago, Brother Albert answered the call to salvation at Community Baptist Church, Community Church over here in Tampa. When A.C. Carpenter was preaching, Brother Albert answered that call. That clear that night, there was no doubt in his mind. He knew that God needed to save, he needed to save him, and God saved him. And because of that day, yeah, he had to enjoy this and celebrate the time. Brother Albert answered a call. He answered a call to serve. When he was overseas, he got in a mess. And in that mess that they were in, he was scared for his life. He told God that day, he said, God, if you'll get me out of this, I'll do anything you want me to do. I don't care. God got him out of the mess. He come home and enrolled in Georgia Tech to be a chemist. And his life's goal as a chemist was to put a cure on the virus. Walking up the steps one day, as he was walking up the steps, he heard a voice that said, go preach. He honestly, literally thought somebody was playing a trick on him. He would always tell me that, and he'd say, well, here I am. He answered the call well before the call to preach, to get the call to take care of his family. Brother Albert, you always like to take care of his family.
Yes, sir.
He always did. He knew what it was like to serve them. He knew what it was like to serve his father. He answered that call. And just back on Sunday, he also answered the call to leave this world.
Yes, sir.
To step away from here and leave everything else. If there's ever been a person this side of heaven, besides some of the ones that's in going through your mind right now, that when he stepped through, they said, well done, my good and faithful servant, Albert Hudson. I thought so much about this day. And I asked the Lord, Lord, what can you say about somebody of such caliber? And I began to think. Two pictures come to my mind. One was this. In my mind, I pictured an old farmer out in the field plowing. Every time you went by the field, he was plowing. Never, ever, ever, ever. You and I can say that about Albert Hudson. Ain't never been a time in your life he ain't been serving God that you knew. He was always faithful to every single thing that he done. And it just pictured in my mind a man that was out every time you drive by, when you sat down and said, you know what, I need a little bit of a break, you could go by that field and see that farmer out there in that field. That was Albert. No matter what was going on in his mind, it was always concerning. Thought about another picture that God gave me, and I thought about with Albert. And this is one I want to take just a minute to share with you. It's the life of an eagle. When I think about all that the eagle is, I think about all he is and was. And I know, Brother Albert, listen. Now I can say what I want to about you, and you ain't gonna say a word. Because if God got done and he is here, he'd get up and say, that's somebody else, not me. Don't brag on me, because there ain't nothing good about me, but I do believe right now it's time that we brag on him, because guess what? He bragged on the Lord, and what he was because of God.
Amen.
Isaiah chapter 40. Verse number 31, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run, they shall not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. I think about a man that didn't faint. Plumb, it don't make no difference. It wasn't a retirement. I sat down in the last 2 days and tried to figure out who in the world's going to fill his shoes. He done so much still. As a part of Liberty Baptist Church. Things that he fell underneath me with and done that I didn't never have to worry about. Because they were done. And I thought about that picture, and I thought about it in my mind. An eagle. Let me just show you a couple things about an eagle. Do you know an eagle is the king of the bird family, just like a lion is the king of the animal family? When an eagle steps up, his presence carries the weight. Let me ask you a question. How many times did that God-fearing, God-man, God-loving man walk in your presence that you didn't know he carried a lot of weight? The things that he said. 10 years of loving and serving with him. I would ask him about people. Trying to find out, to be honest with you, are they trouble or not? I said, you know better than I do. Are they trouble or are they not? He'd just stand there and look at me. One time, me and Caleb was out visiting a couple of months ago, and it's a particular man's name. Back before our revival, we met here every night and prayed, and right, standing right back here where Michael's sitting. I mentioned that man's name, and Brother Albert just grinned and looked at me. I knew what that look meant. But as me and him turned and walked back down through here, you know what he said? He's a character. You know what that meant? Bless God, watch him like a hawk, preacher, because he's a mess. You know what that meant coming out of Albert Hudson? Unless that man gets right with God, you don't want him a part of Liberty Baptist Church. That's what that means. You know what an eagle does? An eagle carries a lot of weight with his presence. You know what else an eagle does? An eagle learns when he's young to get the wind under his wings and soar above this world and all of its trouble.
Amen.
The wind of the Holy Ghost of God. So many times and so many places in every one of your lives. You know how Brother Albert has, God has used him to tell you, you know what, it's going to be all right. So many times in life when things was really down and things was really good, you know what he'd do? He'd get under the wind of the Holy Ghost of God and he'd soar above all the trouble.
Yeah,
this world. An eagle learns at a young age that it can't soar through the leadership of the wind.
just like the Holy Ghost. And then you'll learn after going through tough times, you better eat the meat and stay close to your rock. If there's ever been a man that preached, you better eat the meat, it was him. Without the word of God it being a part of your life, guess what? You're in a mess. And that's what he stood behind. And he stood on the authority of Messiah, the word of God, and he learned in tough times. You know what you need? You need the Bible. Now listen to me well. Let me just go ahead and tell you what he'd say. If the Bible's not an active part of your life, you're not a very mature Christian. Hours and hours that he spent. I love people to try to, you know. But this is just for you. Crowd that don't never read the Bible, but they want to straighten everything out in church.
They want
everything in the church done their way, but they can't back up nothing with the Word of God. He said, "Preacher, just let them go. They'll fizzle out." He said to me, he said, "Leave it alone. Let God do it. God will take care of it."
Amen.
They won't be around long. Just let them have it. Say it that way. Meet the meat. Stay close to the rock. Stay close to the rock. Not only that, but an eagle learns the value of helping others. No eagle, as he flies, there's some eagles that go through a molting stage. And in the midst of that molting stage, all the eagles that have been down a long road and a tough road, and they've been there before, they'll run out and catch fresh meat. The only time you ever see an eagle or ever know of an eagle flying with his claws closed is when he's doing everything he can to get the meat of help to someone else. As that old Christian would be down in the valley, and that old eagle would be way down in the valley, them big old eagles that had already been there before would soar over and drop fresh meat. Have you ever had any fresh meat drops?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Times you thought everything around you is going to be stable. But here it comes. Just one simple little fresh meat. Is that an eagle would drop that meat down there? Some of those eagles would run over there and get it. Some wouldn't. It was their choice. Brother Albert always instructed us and let us know, you do your part, and if they do or don't, ain't nothing you can ever do. Just do your part. That old eagle would run over. Here's what's so amazing. Now watch this. An eagle, when he's helping somebody else, he'll soar around. When he drops that meat, he won't leave them and say, "Okay, go ahead, it's there. If you take it, fine. If you don't, fine." No, but that old eagle, he'll sit up and soar around. And when he sees that other eagle go over there and get that meat, he'll circle in the heavens, screaming from the top of their beak. Screaming, if there's multiple ones, they'll get in harmony and squeal, as to say, guess what? Little baby eagle down there that's in a mess, eat it up, because guess what? You're going to soar again.
Amen.
How many times did you think all the soaring was over? Here God comes.
Amen.
God comes. The eagle. Eagle. Here's what I find amazing about an eagle. Every year, they renew themselves. They say you can take a 100-year-old eagle and a 16-month-old eagle and set them side by side, and one looks as strong and majestic as the other one. Because every year, he refreshes his feathers. He refreshes all the things about him. His majesty and his power always shines through, no matter how old he is. An eagle when life is getting close to the end, gets a look in his eye that he's willing and ready to be set free. When an eagle, listen to me, I'm done. When an eagle senses it's time to go, he'll go to his rock. Every eagle has his rock. He'll go to his rock. He'll take his wings like a cherubim, seraphim, put them over his legs, lean back on the rock, and look straight toward heaven until he breathes his last breath. Can I ask you a question? Sunday evening, what did you watch your secret do? Leaning back. You know what Brother Doug told me? He said, preacher, it's like he was looking somewhere
else. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know what? He knew exactly where he was looking.
Amen.
Exactly.
Hallelujah.
All that that we have enjoyed, all that we get to enjoy because of this man, was because of one thing. A day he got saved.
Amen.
None of this would have ever been real. None of this would have ever been life-changing unless he met Jesus. We're going to do one last thing. Just know what you believe. God used him in my life to put a greater burden for all of us. We have Tuesday night visitation, and he was so excited. The last Tuesday night we were going to have visitation. He was so excited because he got to go out and have somebody met Jesus. Daniel said as a young boy, he was with him one day when Brother Al actually led somebody to Jesus. He said he run home, little bitty boy, he said he run in the house and said, but guess what, Mama, Daddy saved this man. Instantly, Brother Al said, wait, no, God done the same, God has done the same. If there's one thing he would worry about is this. Can you firmly promise, when this life is over, where you'll spend eternity?
Yes, sir.
Can you firmly promise?
cover this top block. We have signified that dear friend. That made the world to me. I'm glad, Lord, there's something on the other side. I pray, God, you help this family. I pray, God, you help Francis. Help Cheryl, help Donna, help Daniel, help this family. I don't think it'll be easy. Pray you help Nathan. Just touch his family with grace and mercy. I thank you for this church. I thank you for Albert Hudson. What he meant to my life. What he meant to me. What a great man of God. God, you've used this man for many years. Do great work for you. We're going to miss him, Lord, but I pray one day we're going to see him again. I thank you for that great peace. And I pray for this church. Pray for those names. Pray God you touch this church. I pray the Holy Spirit of God overshadow this place. The power of God be upon it. Your will be done. And God will love you. Thank you. Praise you. What you've done, what you're going to do. For it's the precious, lovely, and glorious name of Jesus we pray. Yeah.